Well, here we are, and we may seem discouraged because nothing has happened. We may think that we're a failure. We failed and failed and failed and failed and failed. But one thing we have not failed at is we're continuing to try. See, haven't failed at that. Now, are our efforts simply incompetent? No. The problem is the severity of the continuity problem. Our continuity problem is so severe that even though we may try and try and try and try and try, it doesn't necessarily ripen the fruit as fast as we would like. The secret is don't give up. That's the secret, is to keep trying, keep trying. So that means even though you feel like there's no way you're going to succeed, you failed so many times, you're still struggling, you're not clear, you still make the effort. That's what the path is all about. It's an ordeal, it's a struggle. So now there's a tremendous amount of ferment going on with me, and I know something huge is emerging, there's no question. And so, one, have to be patient. Be patient. Don't give up your trying. I don't seem to be able to put it in a perfect explanation at this point. That's okay. Don't need to. So the one thing we don't have to fail at is our daily efforts. We can succeed at that, actually. Nobody can prevent us from trying, right? And some might say, well, it's our trying that is getting in our way. That is not true. That is not true. It's our continuity fear that's getting in the way. This is central, 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 central. And when you do make your breakthroughs, then you look back and say, no wonder why I was frightened. This is incredible. And I'm aware that there's something emerging now where I'm about to see the world in a completely different light. And just literally reverse the whole situation with the world. So of course I'm jittery, you know, and feel like, oh, I can't do it, I can't do it. So usually you'll feel this feeling like, I can't do it, I can't do it. Well, that's because what's about to happen is so tremendous that you feel even with the strength you have, you might not be able to do it. So you just have to maintain your determination. Say, no, I'm going to do it. I will do it. We're getting it done here. It's not easy, though. You get to a point where you think, wow, I could really make this decisive breakthrough. And then you say, ah, but I just can't quite do it. I just can't quite do it. Well, that's the continuity fear. The brake's on a little bit. The brake is on. So first of all, then we'll start out acknowledging our severe continuity fear. This is the key. The continuity problem is key. Continuity problem is key. I have a very severe continuity problem. It causes me to slam on the brakes, even though I may be right there where I need to go, slam on the brakes and say, well, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute. And so we just have to get on good terms with this continuity problem, gradually evaporate it, and just keep trying to evaporate it. It doesn't have to be pretty. Who said evaporation has to be pretty? There's no stipulation that has to be elegant or pretty. Evaporation is evaporation, right? We're not in an artistic contest here. A spiritual path is not some work of art, really. It's a work of genius, really, but not art. Again, evaporation is not art. And that's what we're doing. That's what we're doing. And it works. So we are not bound as we imagine ourselves to be. We have the brakes on because of the continuity fear. And that continuity fear is a dreadfully strong concern of ours. Dreadfully strong concern of ours. In fact, this whole world could be seen as just a defense against that fear. The whole world could be seen as a defense against the continuity fear. that we're identifying threats here, and we have all these rationale for this world, what we're doing here. But really, it's only a situation where our continuity fear is so severe we think we need this world. That's why we think we need this world. Everybody is here in this world because they believe that they need this world. And why do they believe that? They believe the continuity fear that they have is so severe that it's not solvable. It's not resolvable. And therefore, they need something other than reality. They need something that turns their attention away from the continuity fear. Other problems. They need all, we need to be preoccupied with all these other problems, supposedly, so that we don't focus on the continuity fear. Because if we do, we would feel like defeated, hopeless, helpless, we think. And so we're busy solving all these other problems, busy solving others' problems, all these threats and problems here in the world. This world is full of conflict, threats, problems. Now, there doesn't seem to be much enlightenment in this world, right? Very few. It's true, very few. In fact, the amount of spiritual intelligence on this planet seems to be very, very low. And in fact, it is. That's because this planet is where you go when you believe the continuity fear is unresolvable. And you want to just distract yourself from what you believe is this terrible fact that you can never go home. Therefore, you're trying to make this world your home. Okay, trying to make this world your home. So those who find themselves believing they're here in this world are those who have very severe continuity fear. So severe they think that we think that it's can never be resolved, it's impossible. Therefore there's no reason to even think about it. No reason to even think about awakening from the dream. Instead, we feel like we need to just be preoccupied with the activity of this dream, all the troubles, all the challenges, all the threats, and on and on and on. There's deeper explanations that also tie in, but we don't need to tie everything in together right now. That's important. Don't stop your progress just because you can't tie it all together. Just keep on going. The spiritual intelligence of this planet is abysmally low, because the world is inhabited by those who feel that there is no hope to solve the continuity problem. It's hopeless. So why even try? So they don't try. They don't even try. They instead believe there's all these other problems. Health and wealth, survival, all that. And this world is a place that puts on this show of problems. That's what it's for. That's what this world is for. This world is for those who believe the continuity problem is not resolvable. That's what it's for. So, I say this. It does a great job of distraction. Okay? This world does a great job of distraction. This world and other worlds, you know. Okay. Now, is there something wrong with that? No, nothing wrong with it. Those who are that fearful absolutely deserve to have a place that distracts them from that fear. When they get to the point of believing that they can never wake up and know their true functioning, because the continuity fear is just too extreme, then they're just in this incredible dread, and they need this world then to distract them. Okay, so fine, let this world be what it is. This is my point now. I'm getting to my point here. This is the sort of the new teaching that is coming through me here. Let this world be what it is for those who need it. It's an insane asylum. Okay. Don't try to turn the insane asylum into some beautiful place, because what are those who need the insane asylum going to do? They're going to act up. Because for them, that means they have to turn and face the continuity fear, actually. If they were in a world with no problems, they'd have to, the continuity fear would be the only, obviously, no hiding from it. And if they thought they couldn't be fixed, they would feel that would be like utter annihilation for their spirit, be completely dispirited. So, this world is a place where those who feel they would otherwise be completely dispirited, it's a place to come and they can do their little therapy. Like an insane asylum, you give them little tasks to do, you know, and they're not completely dispirited. All right, you give those in like in mental health facilities little repetitive tasks of various things, you know, and they just do little things over and over, and they get a sense like, hey, I'm doing something, I'm accomplishing something, I can do something, and that gives them at least a little bit of feeling like, wow, I'm not, the fact that I can't resolve this continuity problem ever, maybe that's okay, I don't know, but maybe at least I'm not completely dispirited. The insane are those who feel completely dispirited. So this world is like an insane asylum with all these little tasks that people do so they don't feel totally dispirited. Now, what I suggest is we simply let this world be what it is. Stop trying to change it. Stop trying to make it better. Stop trying to reform the world. Just let it be what it is. It's a mental health facility. It's an insane asylum. That is needed. The worst thing we could do is try to change this world, actually. It's the worst thing you can do. That causes all sorts of problems. Simply let the world be what it is. Don't try to make it better. Don't try to change it. Allow the insane to come here to do their things. Because that distracts them from a sense of being totally dispirited. Okay, we don't want anyone to feel totally dispirited. So this world serves a very useful function as it is. Body, perception, everything, atmosphere, ecosystem, materiality, you name it, delusion, everything here serves a purpose to for those who feel they would otherwise be completely dispirited. Now, what happens for those who realize they can solve the continuity problem, such as myself? I realized that. I've always known it, but I realized it, truly experienced it in 1978. And since then, I've known from an experiential viewpoint standpoint, in this world even, in this insane asylum, even though everybody here is here because they believe it cannot be resolved, almost everyone, still, I know it can be resolved. Therefore, I know that it can be resolved for everybody here in this insane asylum. There's not one who will ever come to this world who cannot have their continuity problem resolved. I know that for a fact, because the Holy Spirit is with everyone. Knowing this, there's no reason to try and change this world and make it something different just for my own sense of security, like, hey, this place is so terrible. If people come here, they'll never get better, or something like that. That is not true. It's not true. From the very depths of spiritual despair, you will rise up all the way to knowing your freedom. So, my viewpoint is, don't try to mess with this world. Let it be what it is. This is an extraordinarily different viewpoint than what I've come across in this world, where everybody's trying to improve the world, make it better. Well, what they're really doing is trying to develop new, different types of therapy to help the insane stay preoccupied and distracted, actually. That's what they're really doing, which, from their standpoint, also reassures them that even though the continuity problem may not be resolved, can't be resolved for some, at least they can have some sense of self-worth or something, you know, it kind of reassures them. That's not necessary. For some, that's necessary. So for some, they feel it's necessary to dwell here and to act as though they're helping others out, at least maintain a sense of some self-worth, so to speak. Okay, fine. But what if you know the truth about the situation, and then you know for sure, everyone is going to awaken from this dream of Well, everyone is going to have the continuity problem evaporated eventually. Even though they may spend a lot of time in distraction and not even get started, it doesn't matter, they still will. What do? We don't need the world, actually. Don't need the world. I don't need the world. I do not need this world. And yet, I have to recognize that others do. Because of the continuity problem is so severe for them, they're as yet, they're feeling like it's not possible to resolve it. So they engage in magical thinking, double binds, and more magical thinking, and just desperately try to remain distracted by solving life problems here, feeling that this makes them, you know, competent, gives them a sense of competency. But for me, I don't need this world. I don't need to solve all these little petty problems of this world. I get no satisfaction out of that, really, at all. And I just feel like I don't even want to do it. I have no interest in functioning in this world. I really don't. It doesn't give me any sense of pride or anything to say, yeah, I can function real well in this world. It's like, so what? Yeah, I don't need this world. So what do we do? What do? When we realize we don't need this world, do not need this world. Now, I suggest that we exchange this world for paradise. Make that exchange. Where paradise is a world where there are no problems. And so you can then directly be aware that your only problem is the continuity problem. Because there are no survival problems whatsoever. So you can be fully aware and focus on your continuity problem under those circumstances. And quickly evaporate it. Very quick, you know, finish the evaporation up. Now, there may be several steps to paradise, as it were. Paradise is like we'll be exchanging this world for another world. A world that is obvious that only that love is, and love and the living light is appearing as all these appearances of trees and whatever, you know, whatever the landscape is. That it's the light itself that's obviously appearing as that and nothing else. That there aren't any forces at all at play except your desire and the response of love and the living light of love to provide the appearance for you. It's obvious. This is called paradise, supernatural world of paradise. So what I say is the way you graduate from this world is you realize you don't need it anymore. You don't need it. You don't need to distract yourself from what you believe that you're a total failure. You don't need to distract yourself from your belief that you're a total failure because you realize you're not a failure. I remember when I turned away from absolute chaos and said, no, I can't abide in that, and the ego was just furious with me, said, you're a total failure. You're an absolute total failure. I said, no, I'm not. I'm turning away from this chaos. That's a success right there. So you're lying. I realized right away the ego was lying. So I realized that I will, the Holy Spirit says, you will go all the way to awakening. You will do that. So when the Holy Spirit told me that, and I said, I know this is true, then I realized I'm not a failure. How can I be a failure when I'm going to succeed for sure? That's ridiculous. So in that mindset, this world is unnecessary. It is absolutely unnecessary. It's not necessary to experience problems. Totally unnecessary. It's not necessary to work on fixing problems. Totally unnecessary. I don't feel any desire to fix problems at all. Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead, meaning let those who believe that there's no chance to resolve the continuity fear, let them have their world. Let them have their world. Don't try to take it away from them. Obviously, when you go to paradise, you will not be affecting this world directly, right? When you exchange this world for paradise. And for some reason that seems to, you know, bother us. Like, no, we don't need this world. Yeah, but aren't we supposed to make it better? No. Just let it be, let it be. Let the dead have their world. You know, burns us with consternation, but we need to look at this and hear this. We're always taught that we're graded by how much love we bring to this world and how much we improve the world, etc., leave it a better place. That is not true at all. That is not true at all. That's the continuity fear and its teachings. Most of the teachings we hear in this world are the teachings of the continuity fear. We call it the ego, because the continuity fear telling us what it thinks, what it believes is we need to hear. And it always says that this comes from God or Jesus or ascended masters or some source, right? The ego always claims some exalted source for what it's saying. Almost all the teachings come from the ego in this world, telling us, no, this world, we have to do this. No, we don't. We just have to realize we don't need this world. We don't need this world. We don't need problems, because we've accepted we actually only have one problem. You see, when you want to deny the continuity fear, which is the only problem we have, and you say it's unsolvable, then in order to yet turn our back on that, we want to see many problems to account for this feeling like, I got a severe problem, you know. Instead of seeing this one problem, we say, no, oh, I see my life, wow, look at this, I've got so many problems. You know, the bills, no money, no job, bad health, no friends, can't, you know, the I feel like I'm going to get in trouble here and trouble there, and why am I this, blah, blah. And there's like thousands and thousands of problems that we can come up with, right? And we think, oh, you see, that's where this feeling of a problem is coming from. That's where the feeling of difficulty in resolving problems come from. All these problems that the world is giving me. Instead of recognizing, no, I'm spirit, I just have one problem. I've tried to turn my back on God, on myself too. And I'm afraid to turn around again, because I'm afraid it'll just be so wonderful that I can't stand it. I can't stand it. That is the truth. The truth is, we feel we cannot stand how wonderful it is when we simply turn our attention to the fact that we're perfect, everything's perfect. And in doing this several times, I was aware that the joy, the happiness, the relief, you know, was so pure that I felt like I couldn't stand it. I couldn't stand it, really. And so now, you know, that's understandable. We would say, whoa, I can't resolve this. It's too pure. That's a continuity fear. So what we do is we say, you know what? God understands we have a continuity fear. So that means God must have a way to help us out with this. So if we just say, God, okay, I'm going to say that we can resolve this continuity fear together. So just help me out and show me the way. Reveal the way to me that's called gradualism. Reveal the way of gradualism that's instead of trying to solve problems, I say, no, I don't have any of those problems. I only have the continuity problem. Reveal the way that this is gradually resolved for me instead of all at once. You see, the ego keeps saying that we need to resolve it all at once. And then we say, ah, it's not possible. And the ego says, see, it's not possible. You can't do it. Okay, focus on this world. The ego is, we're denying the Holy Spirit when we say that, because the Holy Spirit is the agency whereby we're able to do it gradually and subtly, actually. So ask the Holy Spirit to bring an infinite flow of endless miracles in the name of Jesus right now, and let the Holy Spirit adjust appearance, time and space, appearance, form, whatever we think we still believe in, adjust all of that, all of it. So gradually, you feel that you don't need these problems, you don't need these problems. Eventually, you don't even need this world. You don't need a world full of problems. But, and yet, you're not without a world, you see. If we thought that this world was the only world there is, then truly we would certainly have reason to say, wow, this is a really tough situation. Very tough. But if we say no, this world is an insane asylum. That's like saying the inmates in insane asylums thinking this is the only place there is. And they go outside the gates of the sane asylum. I go, what the heck is this? You know, I must be crazy. And they run back inside the gate, say, wow, I don't want to keep me in here. It's crazy out there. So that's the attitude, is that, oh, the attitude is, oh, there is no other world. There is no other place for us. This is it. We're stuck here. We're stuck with all these problems. And we have to then slave away, you know, slave away. Try to solve the problems of the world. So we can feel that we don't have a problem, you know. It doesn't work that way. So even though the ego's saying, oh, you're wrong, I'm gonna keep talking here. Because I feel that the ego, it's the strongest suit that it has, is claiming this is the only place there is. And then that justifies you continuing on with all this problem solving, which is distraction, which is a way of denying the one problem you have, you see. This world's customly designed to deny the one problem we have. So it would seem to be the most cumbersome and difficult way possible to try and completely free yourself from the continuity of fear while living on this planet. That would be the most difficult path of all. And very unlikely to succeed. It would seem to me that you should spend your time on this planet preparing to accept you don't need this planet. You do not need this world. Without denying it to others. See, this is the key. Without denying it to others. Now the fear is that if we leave this world for paradise, exchange this world rather for paradise, that we're worried that everyone here, things will get so bad that nobody will ever succeed here. And therefore, if they don't succeed, we can't really be one, you know. This is not true. You must have utter, total faith in the Holy Spirit, that the Holy Spirit will resolve each and every case perfectly, which I believe is true. And the fact of this world getting worse, that doesn't matter. That just means that people here want to be distracted for a while longer, is all. That's all. They want to keep on believing that they can't solve their continuity problem, thus they want to be distracted for a little while longer. That is fine. It doesn't matter. The Holy Spirit is not bothered by our feelings of time. So I would say insisting on trying to solve your problems here is a lack of faith in the Holy Spirit. Lack of faith in the Holy Spirit. Meaning you really want to stay here to keep tabs on everybody else and to try to get them to do better so you feel more comfortable about eventually leaving this world. Because you know if they aren't healed, if they don't wake up, your awakening is not complete, right? See, if they don't wake up, your awakening is not complete. However, what I would say is this, that their awakening is already guaranteed. Everyone's awakening is totally guaranteed without the vision of oneness showing me this. Nobody is even in a pit at all. There is no pit. So their awakening is guaranteed. God guarantees their awakening, has guaranteed it. So each one of us, our job is to accept our own awakening. Now at some point, we may find ourselves back in this world as examples that the continuity of fear has been resolved for us, you see. And if it's been resolved for us, it can be resolved for everybody. And the world does not need that many examples like that. That's why there's only been a few throughout history. It's enough that there be these few really strong examples. And people say, and then you say, wow, I can see that the Holy Spirit sends these examples into the world and says, look at this example. And maybe that it's better to send just really good examples into this world because it's such a crazy place. And people are really sick here. And it's probably better to have just a few really good examples here. So people won't be overwhelmed by too many examples. And the really good examples be a shining light to the world. So one thing you do as you exchange this world for paradise, you realize you're not going to be some great shining light to this world. So that's humility. You be humble to recognize that. Is you're not continuity free. You're not free of the continuity problem yet. And even if you do, if you are free of the continuity period, you may not be sent back to this world because only a few are needed. And the temptation here is to think, wow, if I could just, you know, be witness to the people here, it means that I must be continuity free because that, I mean, only the great ones can do it here. So if I can do it here, you know, I can do it anywhere sort of thing. But that's a trap. That's a trap because we can't do it here, really. Not practically, not pragmatically, no. We're still ridden with continuity fear, so it's not possible. And we're failing to get rid of that continuity fear altogether here. We're not finishing up at all. So you see that the great lights that come in this world generally have no continuity fear whatsoever. For example, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma said she never had a body. It's the first time ever. Had no karma whatsoever. Zero continuity fear whatsoever. She is able to be a great light here, which was necessary because the craziness that she was faced with was just unbelievable. And she said nothing bothered her in the slightest bit, but if one of us tried to do that, there's no way we could function like that. There is no way. And so we'd be teaching a mixed message. And the problem is, in this world, is that people here are so frightened, so much into denying that they even have a continuity fear, that if you try to teach a mixed message, they're going to just chop you up like mincemeat. They require a message that is totally unmixed for a long period of time before it finally sinks in, like, you know what, maybe, okay. Or something very dramatic like Jesus did. Either something very dramatic or something like Anandamayi Ma, 86 years of absolute perfection here. And then, you know, they said, well, you know, maybe, or maybe not. Even that, they say maybe not, but maybe. It's like an attention getter, right? That's how bad off, you know, this world is. This world is like a garbage dump. It's the bottom of the bottom, the barrel, almost the bottom of the barrel, really. I know we like to think of ourselves like this, oh yeah, this planet's so enlightened and intelligent. No, it's not. No, it's not. So all we have to do is give up our pride in thinking that we need to somehow be a great savior here, a great guru, great teacher. Because obviously that would show to God, look how free I am of continuity fear. But are we free of it? Are we fooling God? Is God sitting there saying, you know what? If they could really witness here and be a shining light one more place, then that would mean they're free of the continuity fear. It doesn't work that way. All right, brief interruption. That's okay. Sometimes you can't pick up the flow of thoughts. That's perfectly okay. You just have to expect that. Not a problem. It's all good. This is all just permeating. It's like drinking water. All water helps out hydrate us, right? So. This world is a world for those who want to solve problems, okay? For those who believe they need problems to solve, it's a great place for them. So let it be. Just let it be. Now, I believe there's intermediate steps to paradise. We just don't leap there directly. All right? We could, but I believe it's better to take several intermediate steps. Now, I was talking about we don't need to be great teachers here. That's what you give up. You give up. Oh, you're trying to convince God. Okay, trying to convince God that, hey, God, see, I don't have any continuity fear. That's nonsense. We do. We do. So we shouldn't try to be posing like we don't. And to try, I think, this is the way I'm looking at it, at least taking a look at this, to try and be a great teacher here and turn your back on paradise and the steps that could lead you to being a great teacher is really an expression of the continuity fear, saying, whoa, I'm not ready for that, and I don't want that. I'd rather stay here in this world. Why? Because there's so many problems. I really believe that that what we fear most is not having any problems. Because then we'd realize that we only have one problem, and it's very severe, the continuity problem. And then that would bring us face to face with, well, can it be resolved? Which then requires believing, trusting in God. And we're afraid that God is angry at us, so we can't trust in God. You see, so when people say, no, I want to be a great teacher here in this world, well, what they're really saying is, I want to have a lot of problems still. I want to believe in problems instead of just one problem. We only have one problem. So this is how I'm looking at it. And I believe that those who evaporate the continuity fear, they will find themselves in intermediate steps to paradise. Okay. Intermediate steps. Where they will get used to, wow, there's a lot less problems here. You know, for instance, there are places in this world where it seems very safe, very peaceful, very harmonious, you know, and just, it's like you live there and you say, wow, there just doesn't seem to be anything going on. There was no problems, very few problems. Of course, there's still problems of aging and all that stuff. The body, which also doesn't need, can also be turned into not any having any problem, really, that too. But that's kind of difficult here in this world, because you could turn your body, which is only appearance, everything's only appearance, you could have your body look 20 years old again, or, you know, youthful, whatever. No glasses, everything, just like a 20-year-old, you know. Of course, your identification would show you as looking completely different. And then people insist you have a fake ID, you know, and then who are you, you know, and you might get arrested, and your life might be hell, because people, we don't know who you are. Obviously, you got all this fake identification. They'd get all confused and prove who you are, you know. It would freak everybody out, because they want the problem of aging. See, this world wants the problem of the body, of aging, of sickness, of accidents, of infirmity, of all the vulnerability. They love the body because the body brings all these problems to them, which is a distraction device, away from recognizing they only have one problem, which is the continuity problem, because they feel it can't be solved. That would utterly demoralize them, okay, dispirit them. So they love the body and all its problems. Anyway, intermediate steps to paradise, you can find yourself in a place that is just like, wow, this is so nice. This is so wonderful. And I have found myself in those places, actually. You know, why I'm not there right now is a question. Is a question for me. And maybe it's because I'm trying too much to teach. That is a possibility. Trying to say, no, I'm afraid of paradise. I'd rather establish myself as a teacher here. And they say, well, I can't leave because, you know, I'm teaching. I'm solving so many problems here. I'm helping so many people here, even though I may not be. So that is a possibility that I'm actually. But on the other hand, I'm also explaining the situation to people, at least giving them a heads up on the overall big picture. I don't know, but I'd certainly like to find myself in a place that has less problems. In an overall less problematical situation. Having been in places in this world, which I feel some of the most wonderful places in this world, actually spending time there, spending time where the peace is so strong, you could cut it with a butter knife, you know, you could just, it's palpable. And the feeling like there simply is nothing wrong is just palpable. You know, like I just wanted to stay there and not move. And, you know, I really want that more of that experience, that is for sure. But I haven't been able to build upon that, unfortunately. So I'm just concentrating on this taping to make a big push in that direction. But there is, so finding yourself in those places where you just say, wow, this feels so problem-free. This just feels like a place where problems really don't really appear very much, you know, just wow. This gets you ready for, this is one of the intermediate steps towards paradise. Now, you could also exchange this world for another world, which is an intermediate step, like a fourth dimensional experience, like on Venus or something like that, where it seems like, wow, this is so much better. There's so much fewer problems here, wow. And that would be another intermediate step. And then eventually you can get to paradise, the death-free realm, where just, there's no sense of problems whatsoever, ever there. Never been a problem there. But having it out like that. So this is the way. You may think, oh, these people here in the world, if they only knew about paradise, they'd all go there. No, they wouldn't. Because they say, where are my problems? Where are my problems? Because they don't trust God. Because they tried to displace God. And they don't have the confidence that God, that they didn't succeed. And they haven't recognized that it's impossible to succeed. And they haven't repented. And so even though they could look at paradise and say, oh, it's so beautiful, so lovely, but, I can't stay here, see ya. I found myself in a place that was incredibly beautiful, and I tried to invite everybody there, and nobody went. I had to actually finally bring someone there, and they said, oh yeah, this is very nice, and now let's get back to our problems. Let's be reading the newspaper and watching TV, like that, gotta get back to these problems here. So, actually, the worst thing you could do to anybody is to take them from this world and put them in paradise, because then they would freak out so bad that they would... A person who's not prepared would freak out so bad, they would just come back and want to stay in this world forever. Just, I need problems forever. I just want problems forever. Sickness, you name it, whatever. Everybody else is sick. I'm dying. Just please, problems. So it is only those who have evaporated the continuity fear, worked on that directly, who are able to go to these places. Now, but when you get to these places, there's nobody there, almost nobody there. And that's another problem. I found myself like, wow, how do I share this with people? How do I let people know that this is there? How do I... Well, the Holy Spirit knows it's there. The Holy Spirit knows it's there. It'll tell everyone. If someone needs to be told, the Holy Spirit will tell them. I don't have to be playing the role of the Holy Spirit for people. That itself is an expression of my continuity fear that I don't want to go further, you see. Wow, there's nobody here. How can I share this with everybody and tell them about it? I better go back to the world, you know. That means, whoa, this is so beautiful. I'm afraid that there's no problems. I'm afraid of what if I feel even more there's no problems? What will happen, you know, to me or something? The one who has problems. What will happen to problems? So that's the real reason that we resist it. And what I feel is we go back to the world and then try to develop all sorts of problems so that we have something to go back to, problems to go back to. So then we go to a place that's way better and we'll say, yeah, this is really nice. I'd really like to stay here, but I got all these bills to pay and I got to go back home and work and, you know, this. In other words, if we make excuses, we make sure that we have these bad problems that prevent us from doing it. This is how we work. Fear works in mysterious ways, actually. So we sabotage ourselves. We're always sabotaging ourselves to make sure that we have all sorts of problems. Because we think the continuity problem is overwhelming for us. But I'm sure it's not. It is not overwhelming whatsoever. Just a little bit of right activity, right focus, right attention. Spend some time in paradise and you will easily get it. You'll easily get it. I'm convinced of that. So maybe there are not many there in paradise. Okay, well, still, you can use that to be continuity fear free. You can get free of your continuity fear. At that point, you know, you can really be helpful to the Holy Spirit. But up until then, it seems like you're teaching a mixed message, very much teaching a mixed message. Now, the ego says this is all nonsense. Now, we all have to do it here in this world. I just don't feel that way. From my own life and seeing what's happened, I feel that there is a death-free realm. There are fourth-dimensional realms. There are places in this world where it seems that it's very much problem-free. There are ways to be aware of this, and there are ways that you can go to such places. And it seems to me that just is the most pragmatic way possible to to deal with it. And the fact that not many from this world might be going to paradise doesn't mean that there aren't won't be many in paradise, actually, because they come from all over, all the worlds. It's just that this world, you wouldn't expect many from this world to be able to accept this. That would be unusual in this world, actually, to see this. It's only because I spent a lifetime of just intense effort at this that I'm able to even look at this. It's not taught in this world. It's usually not taught at all. And that's why not many are paying attention. It just seems too much of a miraculous situation. How could it be? Because this world is a place that those who again, are into denying that they even have a continuity fear, let alone resolving it. They never put enough attention on the continuity fear to even consider how it might be resolved. The whole idea of saying, well, it needs to be resolved instantly, what they're really saying is they only have an instant to pay attention to it, and that's all they can give to it. They're so afraid. So they look at it, it wasn't resolved. Forget it then, it's not resolvable. That's how afraid they are. They're not willing to put their attention on it. So I put my attention on it for a lifetime, and therefore I'm in a position to say, hey, I'm not afraid of paradise. I'd love to go there. And if there's some intermediate steps, then let's go. Let's go. Because how can you teach here if people are only willing to, for an instant, to put their attention, can I fix it? No, it's too strong. Okay, that's it. It has to be either it's all at once, done all at once, or it can't be done. You know, setting up false options. Double bind right there, false options. And dismissing gradualism altogether. That's dismissing the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's all about gradualism. So that's still denying God. They're still trying to be the author of their own salvation. So you cannot teach under those circumstances. You can't teach gradualism to those who insist on suddenness. They'll reject it every time. They'll list to you and say, is it sudden? How do I do it suddenly? I only want to look at it for an instant. Remember, they're thinking about the fear of looking upon absolute chaos, which can only be looked upon as an instant. But resolving the continuity fear means you accept that there is no absolute, there is no chaos. There is no chaos. That's just a desire on our part. And actually, reality's perfect. But remember, that's what we're afraid of. We're between the horns of a dilemma, between absolute chaos and pure and absolute perfection. You see, so the Holy Spirit bridges this gap for us, bridges the gap. We have that gap, and we think it's too difficult to bridge such a fearful options. And we have to realize that no, we have to choose that reality is perfect. So that takes absolute chaos off the table entirely. But again, most of us are more afraid of absolute perfection of reality than we are of absolute chaos. We're more frightened of that, actually. We think absolute chaos is necessary because we're so frightened of perfection, absolute perfection. But of course, we can't tolerate absolute chaos either, so we defend against that. This world also, you could say, is a defense against absolute chaos and a defense against absolute perfection. And a defense against recognizing the continuity fear. This world is totally defensive in nature, totally defensive. And when you don't have this fear anymore, why do you need something that's totally defensive? You don't need it. Don't need it. If you don't need this world, where do you go? I mean, I'm not ready to simply leap into formlessness. I'm not ready to leap into formlessness. I mean, it's possible I could do it, but I don't really feel like I want to that much. It crosses my mind occasionally, sure. But I say, you know, I'd rather do it, you know, the safe way. Let's do it the safe way and let's get it done. So at some point you have to stop trying to be a person of the people, you know, a person of the people. Because again, they're not interested in salvation. They're interested in strengthening their defenses against the options they see as either absolute chaos or absolute perfection. And they say, neither, I don't want either. So they're trying to figure some third option out, you know, it's neither one of those that leads to neither one of them. But the path of gradual evaporation of the continental fear definitely leads to recognizing absolute perfection. It does lead there. And so one has to eventually get on that path. Now, when you get on that path, you're not going to be a person of the people. You're not going to be able to talk to the people. They're all going to agree with you. Yeah, yeah. No way. Else they can get lost. We don't want to listen to you. You're scaring the heck out of us. You're saying that we can do what we feel is impossible to do. No, you're wasting our time. You're detracting from our defenses. And so you will not be able to come to this world and get everybody to agree with you and accept what you have to say. Most people here will hate what you have to say. So you cannot be a person of the people here. So, you know, why even try? Why even try is the question. So these are issues that I'm struggling with. I'm like, wow, why even go for that, you know? It's crazy. Go ahead and accept, you know, the beneficial situations for myself, what means problem-free, more and more problem-free situations. And of course you realize, oh, how terrible it is that there are people, and poor people struggling with problems. They want those problems. Without those problems, they feel they couldn't exist. They feel without those problems, they wouldn't exist. That's a fact. We think that the world's putting all these problems on people. People are putting themselves in this world on purpose because that the problems, this is where the problems are apparently. This is where it's apparent. Even though they're not real, they're apparent. And that's why people come here. They put themselves into situations that seem very problematical on purpose, on purpose. Of course they say, suffering, suffering, suffering. But you say, okay, let's drop it. No, that's even worse, even worse. And so it takes the Holy Spirit is in charge of all this. So let the Holy Spirit be in charge. And we'll see what I can do as far as what's next. Trying to make the next step is all. Trying to make the next step. You could either choose a life of grace or a life of problems. One of the two. The life of grace is certainly going to put you in better situations where just it happens for you. You get guided into a wonderful situation and it's like, wow, very few problems here. What do? You just experience this. And then you also contemplate, and you also pay more and more attention. Your attention is freed up to focus on the continuity problem more and more and more and more. And eventually you realize, hey, I don't even need this place. I need a place where there's even less problems. So this is how I see it working out. This is how I see that God has the capability to provide this gradualism for us. Even when it comes to planets, even when it comes to dwelling places. God has the capability to provide this gradualism for us. We have a capacity to go to a different dwelling place and there's much less problems. And those around us have much less problems. The whole situation feels like, wow, very, very few problems here. Very little I need to do to solve any problems. Therefore, I can work on solving the one problem that I really do have, which is the continuity problem. Okay, let's see what kind of fruit this train of thought brings about. Very great, that's it.